I feel like, can I cry first before I start? Because I always have this habit of crying. And I don't want to cry anymore.
Crying, it makes the heart is soft, mashallah. I was reading Imam Shuhayb Webb's advice. He said, when your heart, it feels like crying, that's the best time, one of the best times to make dua. Because that's when your heart is most soft. Right?
Okay, so inshallah, maybe you can... So it's not crying, that's fine. Dah lah, okay. Cakap pun tapi I macam, oh my God, inshallah. So many memories for me. So, okay, I tried to, like, kalau boleh want to break the ice of the common hijab sharing session and cut things short kalau boleh so that we can actually discuss more things about experience. Okay, so I started wearing hijab in 2012, right? Cut it short, I went through so much already before that. And being a celebrity at that time, I had a lot of personal issues. So in the limelight, it wasn't about anything yang macam kata, on my journey in my career, it wasn't, I didn't have any issues though in the limelight. It was just always highlighting on whenever I got married or when I got divorced. So it was heavy for me, and at that time I became a single mother for 3 years at a very young age, in my 20s, right? And up to a point when I met somebody else, I asked myself whether I'm ready to actually move forward again in this life of marriage. And at the same time, I knew that from young I was always searching for religion. People may not have seen it, but I was searching since I was God knows how old, like since high school. One of the funny experiences that I did have was in high school, I felt so close of wearing the tudung, kan? The himar. And I had it in my bag, and every time I went to school, I would wear it, and when I reached the gate, I took it off. Because in school, I would always be, because I was mixed, so I would be considered an alien. And in school, I would always be teased, you know, anak masalila and all that, whatnot. So I was always afraid to head towards that direction. And you know that when we go for holy events, we feel we're like holier than thou. You know, we feel like macam, you feel so close to Allah. And I knew at that young age, I was really searching. I went through so much actually, and I studied a few other things as well. And maybe some of the things that I studied, which I thought were actually, this is Islam, it was not really Islam. There may be a little bit of the deviations of it, because everything that looks Islamic is not totally Islamic. It was also trying to portray it's Islam, but it wasn't. So, and then, I remember that I said to myself, I want to go to Mecca, because I always hear about the holy city, right? They say, if you go there, all your sins will be erased. You can ask for whatever that you want. And then the person that I was seeing at that time, who is my husband now, he was actually really serious about marriage, and I was not ready. I was scared that I might rebel in life because I had so much pain already. And then one day, towards the end, it was looking like it was going to end, this whole relationship, right? And he actually said that he was going to go to make his umrah, and he said to me, I have a gift for you, but you have to follow me. So I remember that I've accompanied him with my daughter to the umrah agency, and he said, I bought you a ticket, here you go. You go on your journey, and I will go on mine. So when I went to Madinah and Mecca, it was amazing, because it's something I've wanted to do for so long, right? Because I tried to do this before, and it never happened. And you know, you spend so much money on going for all these other holidays, but it's always hard to do something better, like for your team, right? And so in the end, somebody who was actually a stranger in my life actually did this for me. And I could see like, wow, there is somebody out there who wants me to get closer to my deen. And then when I went to Mecca, I remember in front of Kaaba, I was like, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. I said, please change my life 360 degrees no matter what. Every single time I face the Kaaba and I make my pilgrimage, I say, I don't want to go home. I was more afraid to go home because I knew that it would be a challenge for me. And what if I go back to what I didn't want to, right? I made dua every day, but alhamdulillah, the journey was fine. I did not realize the test. I only realized the test when I came back. So Allah made it easy for me. That's my daughter, by the way. That's Nisa. That's Fatima. And that's my mom. Hi. So anyway, as soon as because I made so much dua, kan, like I said, bertaubat, I even felt like as if the first time I saw Kaabah, when after I came from Madinah, as soon as we all the jemaah went to Kaabah, I felt as if there was a magnetic force where I felt like, tak tahu apa, what was it, but I felt like this some sort of force was either taking something out of me or just giving something, like, you would feel so pure, like, you feel something has been erased after that whole tawaf, right, and after the umrah. As soon as I got back, I could not go out of the house the same way. I just couldn't, I just had to, I was so already, I felt that, yes, this is the dream that I wanted. Basically, the complete feeling, because I love wearing stuff which is like, you know, flowy, big, just covered. I've always loved that. So, and when I came back, I just felt comfortable in that 2 weeks of pilgrimage wearing the same outfit, right? And then, I didn't actually mention this to my mom or anything. It's just that the days after, they started asking, are you actually wearing your headscarf for good? And I said, yes. Because over there, I already told my husband, I said, once I get back, I think we should just do the solemnization in the masjid, and that's it. I said, I don't want anything big because that's not me. So I said, there's something good and I feel that this is it. I said, I'll just proceed with what is good in my life. So we didn't wait. I think a few days after that, about 10 days, we got married. And alhamdulillah, until today, it's been good for me, the whole marriage. And he has given me a lot of support. So the next step after what happened, then I had to decide in terms of my career, what would I want to do next? Because I said, thank you. Thank you, Nessa. Because, so once I get married, I have to build another family, right? I have to start building my family. I have to build my daughter. I have to give foundation to her. So, and I said to myself, I told my husband, I said, I want to be a better Muslim. So I think this is the chance for me to actually further my studies in Islam. So at that time, I already started going to this place in Taman Tun called Yayasan Ta'lim. And Yayasan Ta'lim has given me so much, basically, it has changed my life as well, because so much ilmu to actually absorb from there and all these other places. And so a lot of people start questioning me, so what about your career, what's next? I say, I leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I know that when I came back, every single day I started crying by the bin. I don't know why, but every single day, I'm like, when I left Makkah, I didn't cry that way, but when I got home, I was just crying. It's like something was letting out. And then I felt so good just wearing my headscarf every single day, and then crying and crying. It's just coming out, you know? And then I said, if my career continues, I don't know, but if it doesn't, I'm okay with it. Because I think I want changes, and I know what is right, what is wrong. So it's about time to make change. Then I not long after I got pregnant, and then I wanted to further my studies at UM. I was rejected because they say that you didn't have usuluddin in your degree in your arts. I'm like, okay, well that's sad, you know, because it was not like a big full course, it was a part-time course, and still I was rejected. And then one day when I was at Yayasan Ta'lim, one day when I was at Yayasan Ta'lim during Ramadan, after Tarawih, the founder mentioned, okay, everyone, we're going to announce something interesting. We're going to have the Imam today, which is Sheikh Dr. Isa Rajab. He is going to collaborate with us. His university is going to start a diploma course soon. And it was 600 ringgit. I was like, what? 600 ringgit and UM is 6,000. I'm like, oh my, oh, okay. So I was like, no, I couldn't wait. I was like, pregnant or not, or baby out or not, I'm just going to do it. So by that time, she was 4 months. Nessa was 4 years old, I think, that time. And so I proceeded with that, and then like my career in acting, I think I only did 2 more jobs, and then I think Allah just closed it for me right away. He just didn't give anything to me, although I rejected a lot as well, but He completely closed that line for me. It was just not for me anymore. And I felt so good that I studied, and it was still a struggle for me. It's not perfect, is how you see this. There are daily struggles, because there are struggles with, okay, first wearing the headscarf, and how do you wear it? How do you wear it? What fashion do you wear it? Because sometimes you can easily get influenced by what is outside. You know, like your friends, who you hang out with, and then what you see. How do you block yourself? And then you meet different kind of people. Like, I noticed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took away certain friends away from me, gave me new friends, and then new friends, which I feel that, oh, everyone who wears the, this is what I felt, everyone who wears the headscarf is perfect. But I was like, I didn't have that much ilmu to actually judge. I always have good thoughts about people. But then again, that's also another test for me. Friends can be testing as well. And then, so when I was studying, I was like, oh my, this is a struggle as well, because I have to bring my kids, and then I have to wait for my husband, and then we have to go to class at night. And then it's at night, and at the same time, I enrolled myself in another class, which after class at 11 at night, there's another class online. So I was like, what am I trying to do to myself? And I said, it's okay, I guess this is what I want, and this is my struggle, and Allah is also testing me during my studies that I have to be really patient and sabah. I would go, I'll drag my kids, and at a point where family too were challenging, because they even said to me, so why can't you just do this when your kids are big? I'm like, no. Because I can't waste time. I wasted too much time and years of not doing this. I have to do this if I want to be a better. So yeah. And then what else? So yeah, that continued, and it is challenging because your iman goes up and down, and then your personality, like you feel like, okay, how should I be? Like, what should I be? Like, what should I share with people? And I love sharing, and I always try to like influence my friends to like, come on, let's go to classes, let's do this, let's do that. And at the same time, I was also afraid I might say the wrong thing, so I try not to say so much and limit myself in terms of the knowledge. And at the same time, I was also still looking for a job, like what should I do in my life? So I started like my own business, and thinking that, okay, maybe doing modest fashion will be it, and because I like fashion, but it doesn't mean that what you like, you're good at it. So I did it for 5 years, and then I decided to just quit doing it when I delivered her. So while I was pregnant to Fatima's pregnancy was so challenging because my iman dropped again, really bad, really bad. No, that's how she's feeling, like a cat, like, suka hati. Okay. A few years passed by, and then, I mean, since 2012, of course there are ups and downs. And then when I got pregnant, then I had to continue my studies again up to degree level for my Islamic studies. And then that's when suddenly I wanted to wear the niqab. So I already wore it previously. This is not my first time. And I remember my lecturer saying to me, he said, oh, mashallah, Natasha, are you serious? When I walked into class one day, I said, yes. And he said, oh, may Allah protect you and guide you and always be you main steadfast. Because he knew that it was going to be a challenge for me. And true itself, it was a challenge for me. So when I wore it before, I used to just wear it before I actually exposed it to my lecturer. Before that, I was wearing it to like events and stuff. Because I felt that every time I wanted to go and learn, everyone would come and take pictures with me, and I just didn't like it anymore. I didn't enjoy the attention. I wanted to just be unknown. So I felt that was an experience, because I felt so calm, and like I didn't have to be out there to people to recognize me. I just wanted to be like mysterious to people, so unknown as well. And then, so when I actually fully decided to wear it, and then I went to class, and then suddenly I got pregnant. And then it was a challenge, because my pregnancy was a big challenge. I was going through like an emotional breakdown and a hormonal roller coaster. And I was like, oh, how am I going to do this? Like, how am I going to do this? And then up to one point, towards the end of my pregnancy, I decided to take it off. and I felt that's it, I failed. My iman is just, I'm just a loser, you know? And that whole pregnancy, till my delivery and after my delivery, I felt like, oh no, my iman is just going down and down and down and down and down. Like, where am I heading in life? Where am I heading? And then my husband, unconditionally, he basically doesn't stop advising me and reminding me that, because you know, there are times us as women, we take things for granted in terms of our solah as well. Like, sometimes lambat zikir, you know, and then sometimes terlajak pula, you know, and it happens. And so when one thing happens, it leads on to another, leads on to another, leads on to another. And then sometimes you don't like people reminding you. Because I'm the type of person, I don't like people reminding me too many times because I like to realize it myself. But of course, I appreciate the reminders. And then, and then I delivered my baby. And I felt really, at one point I felt really empty because I felt like, oh my God, after so many years of being a student of knowledge and suddenly this pregnancy and this delivery makes me feel so empty. And I said to myself, this is why Allah said that women, we are easily influenced, or we are easily, I'm saying, we can easily get lost when we are not in the state of purification. We are not purified, you know? So this is when shaitan will come and attract us and try and influence us that you should do this, you should do that. Because there was a point where I felt that, oh no, now, what do I do next in terms of my career and my finances after delivery? Because women, we just love to think about that. You know, we just feel that, oh, this is not enough. And I always feel that, oh, I have to help my family. It's not so much about me. So I then continue doing, I mean, I was always doing writing and blogging and stuff. And then I decided, okay, why don't I just, I stopped doing my fashion business. So why don't I go back into my fashion blogging and continue it again? And then so like last year, I did a bit of that. But still, I felt that the journey wasn't smooth again. It was just going up and down, up and down. And there's something missing. And my classmates were already doing their masters when I delivered my child, and I was not because I delivered the baby. And I felt like, oh man, like, how come I'm not doing it? Why can't I do it? Why can't I do this? Why can't I do that? And then it's limited again, and then I have another baby, right? But I didn't stop watching things online because there's so much to access to. So even though I feel low, I would always have something in front of me. And I love reading. So every time the kids are asleep, or whenever I can catch time every day, like after subuh or before I sleep, or in between things, I'll just flip even one page. Because one page makes a difference in your life. You know what I mean? And then one fine day, I just decided, like, you know, that's it. What am I doing, right? I have to go back to school. I have to do this. So I remember last year in August, I went back to Australia. A few months before that, I was given the news that my sister had brain cancer. And so I have two family members, my brother and my sister, who has cancer. My brother has had it for 10 years and my sister just got it. So this is my sister that I talk to every day, which she's not the same religion, but she's the sister that I love the most. So Allah, I said to, I clearly remember this many, many years ago. I don't know when, I can't remember what year. But I still remember this, you know, in my heart. Until today, I said, Allah is going to test me one day. One day, He is going to test me that I'm going to lose something that I love the most. And I felt that by having my siblings dying on me one by one soon is one of my biggest tests. And I feel that actually, I'm alone in this world. Really, I feel so lonely. And we have our family, right? We have our husbands, we have our friends. And then it gave me more reflection. Actually, in life, we are loners. We are alone in this journey. And what is it that motivates me really is death. So my death is my motivation to move forward. Like, if I don't motivate myself to be a better human being now, because all my kids, all my husbands, my mom, my father, they're gonna go. And if I don't fix myself, and I don't help them along the way as well, what am I gonna be, right? So, after I came back from Australia, I remember I was in Australia at the time. I was with Kadina, Wadina. And I've been telling her for so many years, I have to. I love the way your kids recite the Quran. Like, I want my children to be like that. And I just love the fact that if I can master more in my tajwid and stuff, right? And so I came back, and next thing I knew that my favorite teacher, which was teaching Kadina, was coming up with classes. And then Allah tested me again. So I went. And I went, and it wasn't easy for me because there were other things that, in terms of the place where I was living was not safe for my children. And then, you know, maybe it was a little bit more expensive for me. And then I said, okay, I'll just not do it. And I was like, no, my heart is longing, it's longing for something, and I have to do something about it. And then my university came out with this advertisement like, okay, there is a course, an intensive course to be a teacher, not in your ijazah, sanad, in Tajwid. So I said, okay, I'm just going to do that. So as soon as I did that last year, I think it changed my life again. You know, I went through another cycle. So suddenly, like if Allah wants to give you an overturn, like 360 degrees, He doesn't wait sometimes. He just gives it to you like then and then. Just exactly like how I experienced it the first time. And then He gave it to me again like last year. So, how do I say, where did I stop?
Okay. Last year.
Yeah, so, but the last few months before that, I was telling myself and I was telling my husband, I said, for some reason, I really miss my niqab, right? It's not that I wore it ever before because of any terms of fashion or anyone forced me. I just felt something, right? And I knew that I had to, before I go back to that, which I didn't know when I was going to go back to that, I knew I had to study it all over again. So I made this initiative to learn about the existence and basically the whole commandment about the covering, how you're supposed to dress as a Muslim. And I remember like Surah Al-An'am has so much in there, and I was studying so much about that. And then I was reading all my books I had on the niqab once again and again and again, like non-stop. And then one particular time, because I already started doing my ijazah for this Quran class, right? I felt that I was getting closer to the Quran again, like closer and closer besides the foundation that I built. And I just felt that, okay, felt that like, I really have to do this day to day, like I have to do it 24/7. I cannot like not hear any of the recitations. I have, and plus, during the classes, we are expected to memorize the Quran. Like we are supposed to come for hafazan every day after class, and that was pressure. Because it's not just about going to class, it's about memorizing all these surahs, which are so long, and all this time you make so much, like, you take so much advantage of only understanding and memorizing the ones that you know. You know what I mean? Because it's more than that, and then you appreciate, and then you value all these others. And while learning, I was telling my husband, I said, oh, mashallah, the Quran, oh my, I just cannot explain it anymore. I said, no wonder Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, or even the Prophet said, this is a book that cannot be changed. Because when you recite something, then your brain's name is a karat and it's resting. It kind of like restarts it and the engine moves and moves and moves and doesn't want to stop. And then you understand like, why are we supposed to read this part and this part? Why does it sound the same front and back? Why did Allah do all this? Like, then you start thinking, why? And then you start thinking about yourself. Why am I here? Like, why? What am I doing right now? Like, I can't be a student of knowledge but not fix myself. And then I asked myself again, why would I want to do something like this? Like, why would I want to change myself again? So one day then there was a time where I said, okay, I'm not going to do this. I'm so tired of this like fashion writing, whatever stuff. So, and I told my husband, I said, okay, I think I could strongly feel that there are going to be changes again happening. And he thought like, okay. I said, oh, so what do you think, you might actually start wearing the niqab again? Okay, good. I'm not forcing you, up to you. He's always like that. So he doesn't like say, oh no. He doesn't have anything. He's always supportive. I think in fact he likes it because he's tired also of the like, that kind of thing. He's like, oh man, malu. He gets shy and stuff. So, and then it's funny because the last couple of months, you know how Instagram, like how social media can influence your life, right? I found so many new friends on social media. Like either they approach me or like when they follow me or I follow them, then we start communicating. And then so happened to be, there were this group of girls who actually wore the niqab. So I actually discussed with them about this issue. Why and how long have you been wearing it? And they're like really young, like 18, 19 and wearing it for 5, 6, 7 years. And I was really impressed because I was like, inshallah, like did that long? Like, how do you do it? Like, what do you put in yourself to remain steadfast? And the niqab itself, it's not something where, it's to me, it's not even an Arabic trend. Because I had to study so much about it, I had to understand where it actually came from, how it happened, in order for me to confirm that it actually, I want to wear it. Meanwhile, it's not wajib, but there are things behind it that makes me want to do it. And then, one day, I just decided to like, okay, I want to wear it. That's it. And then I feel like wearing it. Okay, that's it. And it only took my husband probably like 2-3 days to realize it. And then, of course, I share it with my followers, like little things, you know. First, I share stuff like I share quotes and stuff or whatever, and I share a picture or something. Because I feel that maybe I can, if I do have followers, maybe I can use this in a way to like open their eyes and open their hearts. And I love photography. So if you look at my Instagram, it's got that whole idea and concept, and it's actually the way I want to do da'wah. So, because I do not enjoy anymore, like really doing all the work that I did previously in my fashion industry, I felt that, okay, maybe I can turn it into a different area in a different way. And it's quite heavy. It's a quite heavy responsibility when you go out there and you do it and then people start coming to you. And I get a bit scared because when people start asking me questions, I would, if I can share, I share. But if I feel that I'm not layak to share, I would say, don't ask me as a scholar because I'm not a scholar. Doesn't mean that if I change today, I would know exactly everything in my life. Sometimes to share it with your closest family member, it's the hardest. Sometimes it's easier to speak. To share with other people. So, what was my understanding of the concept of covering, you know, before? I don't know why, but I don't even remember being told that it was a commandment. I just felt that you have to wear it because you're Muslim. And then, now, I understand that it is wajib. It's something, it is our, this is how, I mean, there was a commandment that came down, and from then, this is how you're supposed to dress. When I was doing my research on being prepared to change myself again, like how I should dress, because like I believe that hidayah is every day. It's not something one time and then that's it. No, it's like every day, every month, every year, you learn something new, you go through something new. So whether you're prepared or not, that is something you have to ask yourself. Because it is something that we have to sacrifice for our religion, for us to be a better servant and to be obedient. So, when I read certain things, and I knew I read it, and then I read it again, and I read it again, like, mashallah, ya Allah, you know, Allah made us, or He said that we should wear something like this, like, this is amazing, you know, like, it's amazing. Like, but it is that hard for the ummah still to do it. But, you know, you can't live anymore. It's really the heart, it's really the mind, it's really the eyes, like, whether you can accept it and whether you can absorb the knowledge. And we should be really proud of our image. We shouldn't be afraid or we shouldn't be ashamed. That's how I feel. Like when I look at all the sisters here today, like, alhamdulillah, all of us are on the same journey. Maybe some of you are even better. So like, I always feel that we can learn something from each other. And I still ask questions from others as well. Like, how do you feel like being a Muslim? How do you feel when you wear, when you represent this? Like, you know, who wear the hijab. When we go anywhere, we're still being criticized or defamed and stuff. Like when we travel, we get scared, right? Especially I go back to Australia. When I wore the hijab after 4 years, my first trip back to Australia, I was like a bit afraid. And then I knew, okay, lah, tak apalah, selamat sikit kot because I have my dad's Hudson name at the back, maybe, konon lah, kan? But still, I would still have eyes looking at me. When I went to my nephew's school, and it's an area which is totally redneck, Matsali, no Asians, it's like, anti-Asian place, you know what I mean? I was the only Muslim, and of course, my elder sister said, oh, this is my sister, she's from Malaysia, and we have some, you know, different mother, same father. And then, oh, where are they? Okay. Or else they'll be like, at me, like, you know, giving me the eye, like, what is a Muslim doing here? But then I still want to hold on to it. Like, if I travel, my next step, oh my, this is another image, but like, how do I face it? But I guess we really have to, like, you know, minta kepada Allah. Allah will protect us all the time. And I believe that whatever that you want to do, like when you want to wear the hijab, or you want to change your image, or you want to start something, you want to make dua, you want to solat, you want to do anything, is to really start with an intention. Because Allah knows best. And I thought that maybe because of my intention the last couple of months when I said that, I told myself I feel so close and drawn back to Mika. I'll be like, I feel like, I think I want to I want to take this other step, and I think this is a new step for me, because maybe last time there was a different reason to run away from people. Now it's not running away at all. Now it's facing the world, like face the music, that's it, you know. Now I'm more brave to go to my family events, because when I wore it before, even to my in-laws, they didn't actually know I was wearing makeup. So as soon as I step in front of the door, I'll take it off. Like jump, silat like and jump. So my only mother-in-law kind of knew about it, but the rest didn't know. So this time when I went, the first time my in-laws saw it was when we went to like, what's that, petting zoo place, right? The, yeah, farm in the city. And suddenly my father-in-law said, huh, Minja. He was like, Star Wars ke? They were fine with it. And then faced my mother's family pula kan, and I only faced my mother's family like a few days ago, and I think they knew already because this thing suddenly went viral. And I did not expect that, because to me, my social media, I knew I had like my own followers, and I thought I was not in the limelight anymore, like totally forgotten. Suddenly it went viral, and then kebetulan pula I share pula dengan my blog followers, so people copy and paste this thing. How did I face that pula? Like people asking, how did you react to it? I was shocked, and my husband, that's when he knew. He's like, are you wearing it now for good? Like, keluar masuk rumah, dia ingat just saja je. That 2-3 days after it came up. So, how does it, it was quite overwhelming. And afraid, I was a bit afraid at the same time, because I knew this will be, and it will take another turn. Like, all sorts of people will start approaching. And I didn't want to be, how to say, take this advantage to do something that is against my intention. I want to take it slow. So when I was getting all these other invitations like radio lah, whatnot, I just rejected it because I wasn't ready, because it's not something where, okay, I'll announce it. I'm not announcing my changes. And when the press contacted me, I said, I have nothing to say. There's nothing to say. If you want to know, just read it from the blog. And obviously, even I said there's nothing to say, from your ambil air and put it in the paper. See, can you imagine? I want to run away from you guys, but you guys are still bugging me. So, and like, people still asking me, like, oh, so when what's your next project? Are you going to be in any film soon or TV show? I'm like, what are you talking about? You know, I said, takut, I don't think so. I don't think people want me in a kimar, I mean, in a niqab like this. You know? But if there's, I don't know, who knows, I don't know, but I don't think so, I said, right? Unless there's an offer to do something really good for the religion, maybe. But oh yeah, one more experience I had last year, throughout that journey of going back to find myself, right, after my delivery. So trying to balance my hormones and going back to my religion was a big test, right? I told you guys. So I was offered again to work in the Al-Hijra. And then when I was offered to go back to the TV station, even then, Allah didn't make it easy for me. He didn't even allow it to happen. So I was almost about to start work, but there were things that I started looking at, like the surrounding and stuff and whatever. And I said, oh, I still don't feel that there's something right here. So it just didn't happen. So it's like, I had to be really patient to get what I really wanted. And I had to sacrifice a lot of things, meaning give up my 5 years of building my business, and then start researching on something else, and then starting a new business. And then after this thing happened to me, then I said, I felt like this whole 1 year was like a movie for me. Like, boom, 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 boom. I'm like looking at what happened, right? And then now I'm starting to like sort and susun everything balik. But then I knew that with my intention, he gave me something else, like he pushed me forward to like go back, like come back to me. And if I give it to you, it'll just be like that, right? So went back to the Quran, started classes again, went to classes again, and then last year, I was also saying to myself, I want to start teaching. Because I think my forte is really children, like I can teach them, because I really believe that if we have kids, we really need to build their foundation and the system how it is here. You know, in some of the schools, like, maybe it's not enough time for them to focus and nurture the kids. So why not I apply something for kids out there who need more of the foundation, like the theory part, not just about the Quran and recitation, kan? So I tried doing a bit, like, you know, and then before I started class, I started with my daughter and her friend. And then I was trying to help like troubled children who are like 6-7 years old, but they talk back to their parents, and they were like beyond words at that age. And I'm like, I could change them in a day. Like, wow, one class, boom. Balik mak dia, hi, assalamualaikum, baby. Like, you know, I was like, no, there's something that I think I have to do here besides teaching. And so when I decided to like change that path again and then go back to my studies, and then suddenly all the ideas that I had for myself in terms of my actual career actually is still on the team. That means I started teaching, and then now I'm starting to teach, and now I have classes that I teach. So alhamdulillah, like Allah gives me something that I can still fall back to, and then it evolves the things that I want. So my classes, and then teaching children, and then you know my businesses that I do, right? So now last year, before I went to Australia, I started an organic baby wrap line, and then I had my organic homemade products. So then now, I kind of like put it on hold the other day for a while, and then now I feel that with this like knowledge and absorption that I've been getting, I feel that now I know what I want in my life, and now I know how to like put things together rightly. Because if you can complete your heart, your soul, like if you can feel, if you can put all these things inside yourself to feel content, then I feel that you can actually get all the messages that you want from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because you know, we always like ask ourselves like, why is this not happening? Why is this happening to me? We have all these questions happening, right? Like, why is this like balu? We always say that kind of stuff, like balu lah, tak ada rezeki lah. But because we're not trying harder enough, or maybe we're not asking enough. So that's what I think when it comes to our prayers, we have to ask for more. Like we have to do more. We have to do more like hajj, we have to do more like duha. And I really strongly believe we have to replace our prayers that we always miss throughout the years. Although Allah forgives us, but why not make more effort to do it? So it's what you wear is not just what you wear. What you wear actually is everything. It's a journey to perfect, to become a perfect Muslim. It's a big responsibility, because although our husbands are our leaders, but we are the kings in the house. Because we need to really, as a mother, right? As a mother, as a sister, as a daughter, and as a person in my industry, my kind of business, I feel that I have all these things I have to build to be a better person. In the house, when you have children, that's when you're in control, because your children are really what you are. And then, like my daughter, I don't force her to do things that she doesn't want or what. But you know, like most of the time when she's with me, unfortunately today tak boleh duduk home dia. But most of the time, like when she goes to school, she voluntarily wants to wear it. And when they actually, at a young age, she already started doing it. So like, she wants to do it herself. I wouldn't force her, but I try to educate her about it. Like, and she is one reason why I wore the makeup as well. Because, because she reminded me the other day. She said, "Mommy, I really miss you in the makeup." I said, "Why?" And she said, "Because I don't like it when people look at you. Can't you just hide your beauty? Like, I don't like it when people always want to..." You did, you forgot. So, like, macam, even they are uncomfortable with the fact that when people want to always take photos and stuff. And sometimes I feel that I myself don't want to show my son when I go to the school, because I rasa macam, I don't want the attention, and malu pun ada. So, and it's not fun when she asks me, then she tells me that, "Oh, this year teacher asked me, are you the daughter of so and so?" Like, I wish I could just close that chapter, you know what I mean? I said, "You should say no." Just say no, you're not. But, you know, she wouldn't understand. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, and then So through this journey now, I remember I was reminded by one of the sisters, my Instagram friend, right? This girl who is in Hong Kong. Like, she became a very close friend to me, and she said, you have to remember that you will be tested still, like every single day, every single day. And when I was tested, I was like, oh, crying, oh, why? And she's like, you see, I told you, but don't be afraid of the test. Be better, right? So like, you need friends to remind you. So it doesn't mean that we're that perfect as well. We're still struggling, I'm still struggling. And when I get people asking me all these questions on Instagram, I said, when they say, Katasha, I want to be like you. I'm like, no, don't be like me. I said, be better than me. In fact, be yourself. Because it's not about wearing it because you want to be or inspired by me. I was inspired by the Mother of Believers as well. I said, I was inspired by them. I read their stories and their sacrifice. I said, read about them as well. Understand what they're all about. Understand our purpose in wearing the khimar. Why? It's not just about wearing it or by force. Making the initiative to read more, I was being told, read. Oh my god. I feel that I made this time initiative to read and understand. I said, I didn't just wear it. I don't know why she goes, I don't know. Anyway. So, yeah, that's pretty much what I went through the last couple of years and my recent journey. I always try to istighfar as much as I can, and I read a lot of stuff about Tawheed because, you know, it's everything before your salah. It's about being God conscious, and so I think one thing that really helped me is being God conscious. Like, God is seeing me, He is hearing me, is witnessing every single thing that I'm doing right now. I can't run away, you know, like when time was so long, I'm like, oh, I have to do it now, you know. It's like I can't take advantage of it. I don't care where, now I have to do it anywhere. I'm not afraid anymore, I'm not ashamed. Even if it's at like a place like this or a place in center with my kids, I just open my sujada and that's it. Because that's my responsibility. I asked from Him, He gave it to me, He keeps on giving to me. Why can I not spend more time with Him more than five times a day? Besides five times a day. So, yeah, that's pretty much it, I guess. Always be God conscious. Yeah. Yeah.